of the osteoporosis that means the premenopausal women. When we are speaking about premenopausal osteoporosis or low bone mass, we should stress that it's very difficult to diagnose. Mostly it's caused by secondary causes, and much more is difficult how to treat these patients. Why is that? Because we do not have enough data about the effect of reduced bone mineral density on fracture risk in this group of patients, about clinical significance of low trauma fractures, about impact of disease and their medication on, and there are no large clinical trials about treatment strategies. So let me start with the first problem. How can we diagnose these patients? There are two recommendations. First is from ICD, and the recommendation is that we should use Z-score, not T-score, and if Z-score is less than -2.0 or lower, its definition below the expected range for age, and they do not recommend to use the term premenopausal osteoporosis. Little bit different is the definition of IOF. It's recommended to use T-score -2.5 in women older than 20, and this together with the presence of fragility fractures or multiple fractures or chronic diseases affecting bone metabolism can lead us to the diagnosis of premenopausal osteoporosis. And I added this sentence here that because of this, it's recommended to perform also vertebral assessment in all these risky patients. Why it's so difficult to define from the BMD if the young women suffers from osteoporosis or not, only if we reflect BMD, because we should take in account low peak bone mass in these patients, small stature and constitutional leanness. So, when we have BMD, when we should start working up in these patients, sure, doesn't matter if we are using Z-score or T-score, so it should be low, and sure, if we have any fragility fracture, in this case also regardless of BMD finding. In general, it's not recommended to use BMD evaluation in premenopausal women. There are only some indications like presence of fragility fractures, presence of chronic condition associated with bone loss, or chronic medication which is associated with bone loss, and if you are treating the patients to monitor the effect of the treatment. What about bone tone markers? Also, as it's dubious in postmenopausal osteoporosis, it's the same in this case. They can be low or normal. In that case, it's a sign of low peak bone mass or previous bone loss. If they are higher, probably it's ongoing any bone loss, but we should take in account that high levels can be during growth spurt and sure after the fracture. Here is quite crowded slide. This is algorithm from Serge Ferrari. It is a patient suffering from premenopausal osteoporosis, and you can see that also measurement of bone turnover markers is included, and if markers are very high, then it's one of the reasons why to go more deeply to the examinations of the patient. What about bone quality? I think we are in a very good place to speak about bone quality assessment, and also today we heard something about, and we heard a lot of new informations about possibilities to check bone quality. And we know that it's very important to discriminate mostly patients at risk of secondary osteoporosis, and we do have some experimental possibilities, but we have also clinical possibilities, and TPS is surely the most easiest way how we can check bone quality in secondary osteoporosis, and I will show you some our own data about this problem. So, what about evaluation of secondary cause? We know that if we are speaking about premenopausal osteoporosis, we should also speak about secondary causes of osteoporosis, because according to the data from the 50 to 90% of the premenopausal osteoporosis have their own secondary cause. Here are plenty of secondary causes, and later on you will hear much more about secondary osteoporosis. So all the secondary osteoporosis causes are then in general, but typical for premenopausal is idiopathic osteoporosis in the young and osteoporosis in pregnancy and during lactation. Here you can see which are the most prevalent, and in the red I'm gonna focus on these disorders because I think they are really very prevalent, and we do have our own data in premenopausal women, and I would like to share with the data with you. What lab should be performed in all these patients? It's like in general, we should check at mineral metabolism, renal function, inflammatory markers, hepatic markers, markers of malabsorption, diabetes, and thyroid dysfunction. So all these should be done in the first line, and if it's necessary, we should go to other more specified tests. First, I would like to start with typical disorder, which is typical in young female, but it can be very rarely also in young men, but more than 95% it's the disorder of young female. This is anorexia nervosa, and you know that these girls are suffering from very low BMI, with decreased lean mass, very low estradiol or testosterone levels. There is resistance to growth hormone, relative hypercortisolemia, and there are also other endocrine findings. And all these leads to low bone mineral density, but what's more important, these girls are in very high risk of fracture. It's one of our works, and we found in a group of patients after 3 years of anorexia nervosa, very low bone mineral density after the duration of amenorrhea and more than nine months. So just to stress that these girls are probably in the higher risk of the fractures from all so-called premenopausal osteoporosis. Other huge group of patients is the group of patients suffering from thyroid hormone disbalances. We know that thyroid hormones via many mechanisms are leading to increased activity of osteoclasts, so the osteoresorption is elevated, although there is positive effect on the osteoblast activity of TSH, but this effect is not so pronounced. If we would like to stress which are in the high risk, surely the patients suffering from hyperthyroidism. You can see that mostly BND is decreased in this group of patients. There are not good data what's going on with the patients after the treatment of the disorder, but there are also data that these patients are in very high risk of the fracture. What's maybe not so known, that also if you are speaking about only subclinical hypothyroidism, you can see osteoporosis is one of the indications of the treatment. So in subclinical hypothyroidism, we should always think about the possibility of the osteoporosis in these premenopausal women, and you should screen them with DEXA. This is also one of our study. We performed study in premenopausal women, more than 150, and we checked about the association of TSH and markers with BMD, and we found that higher TSH was significantly associated with higher BMD and lower bone turnover, and the level which was discriminated was 0.3, so if the level of TSH was lower than 0.3, these women, premenopausal young women, were in higher risk of lower BMD. This is one of our recent studies, and I'm very glad that I can thank Neil Binkley, who was one of the collaborators in this study. We checked the bone mineral structure in premenopausal women with hypothyroidism, and we found that TBS reflected better the bone status than BMD. So TBS was very good as a predictor of bone status in this group of patients. A huge group of risky patients premenopausal are the patients suffering from primary hyperparathyroidism. You can see about 1 to 3% premenopausal women can suffer from this disorder, and we know that supranormal levels of PTH can have osteoresorptive effect, mostly on cortical BMD, but it can increase trabecular BMD, but the bone quality is poor also in these patients. And just to stress that also we have many asymptomatic hyperparathyroidism, that means only elevated calcium and PTH, and in the start there are no organ damage, but also these women we should check because there are later on in risk of fractures. Here on this slide you can see the summary of all the changes what we can find in these patients, and just to show you that TBS also in this group of patients can be very helpful, although the bone mineral density can be in norm if you are checking the trabecular compartment. What about growth hormone? Growth hormone disorders is also something which is quite typical for young patients, that means also for young premenopausal women. Growth hormone has its effect in childhood, in adolescence, and also in adulthood. And if we have deficiency of growth hormone, then there is reduced bone mineral density, decreased bone turnover markers, and these patients are in high risk of fractures. We checked the effect of growth hormone after 2 years of treatment in premenopausal women, and you can see that after 2 years there was more than 10% increase of the BMD in lumbar spine in this young female. So growth hormone in patients in whom is deficient is one of the best treatment what we have for the bone. Here you can see another study also with Neil Binkley, that if we checked the levels of vitamin D in the group of patients suffering from growth hormone deficiency, the increase of TBS was only in group with sufficient levels of vitamin D, but the effect on bone mineral density was not statistically significant. So you can see that TBS can be really helpful in this group of patients. What about other situations, that means acromegaly, too much of growth hormone? There are many data showing that BMD in these patients is higher, we know that in the past, but we know that these patients suffer from fractures. So the incidence of fractures is high, although bone mineral density is high too. This is one of our latest studies, also thank you very much, Neil, for the collaboration, and we checked acromegaly patients. It was a huge group of patients, more than 150, but here you can see patients which were premenopausal, and in this group of premenopausal acromegaly patients we found lower TPS and higher CTX, but not BMD. What about diabetes? Professor Mascherano will speak much more detailedly about diabetes. Just to stress that all the patients, although in the suffering from diabetes type 1 or type 2, are in high risk of the osteoporosis, and the pathogenesis is a little bit different. But what's different, that high risk has both types of diabetes. In type 1, it's because of lower BMD, but in type 2, the bone mineral density is quite in norm, although can be higher. Here you can see when we check bone mineral density in diabetic women, and we compared women with diabetes type 1 In type 2, we found that really type 1, these young ladies, they had lower BMD, but ladies with type 2, they had higher BMD to compare with diabetes type 1, and it was comparable with the control group. That's why it's so important to use TBS also in this group of patients. In this study, we checked the relationship between TBS and the glycemic compensation according to the glycine hemoglobin, and you can see if there is good metabolic compensation, then also the TBS is much more higher than if there is decompensation of the disorder. A very frequent disorder what we have is glucocorticoid induced osteoporosis. Is probably the most common cause of premenopausal osteoporosis with high risk of vertebral fractures because there is really accelerated bone loss and mostly deterioration of trabecular bone in these patients. The mechanism of the action, I'm sure you know, it's quite complicated, but in premenopausal women, you should add also lower levels of estrogens, which is one of the main reasons of the osteoporosis in this case. This is the only recommendation what to do with premenopausal women, what we have from the literature. So if we have women suffering from the treatment with glucocorticoids, there is strict recommendation that we should check before the treatment, during the treatment, how to check that, and who should be treated and who should be only monitored. And here we have also treatment options, that means vitamin D and calcium, and if there is a very big risk of the osteoporotic fracture, then and sure in women who do not plan pregnancy, we should use oral bisphosphonates, teriparatide as the second line treatment, and IV bisphosphonates or denosumab only as the second, third line treatment. A huge group of patients are patients suffering from breast cancer because this group patients are oncological patients treated with GNR analogs or tamoxifen, so there is a high risk of accelerated bone loss, risk of fractures, and we are using IV bisphosphonates in this group. Then is a group of chronic inflammatory disorders, although rheumatic disorders or IBD disorders, in whom although we can use bisphosphonates as a co-treatment, or we should much more better control the disorder, which leads to these findings. And this is one of our study. We checked premenopausal women suffering from rheumatoid arthritis, and if we used biologic treatment, it was possible to reduce glucocorticoid treatment, and all these led to higher TBS and osteocalcin in this group of patients. Also, in Crohn's disease is another study in whom we checked premenopausal female, and we found that TBS reflected very well the severity of the disorder. We can have also osteoporosis associated with pregnancy and lactation, you know, because in this situation there can be low estrogen levels, loss of calcium, hypersecretion of PTH and PTH-related peptide by mammary gland, and there is quite high loss of bone mass during pregnancy and lactation. That's why it's necessary to increase the income of calcium in this group of patients, and we can have two types of osteoporosis in these patients, but doesn't matter about the pathogenesis, but the treatment is the same. So here you have the recommendations in this group of patients: high levels of high dose of vitamin D and high dose of calcium. With the treatment in this group of patients, it's problematic. We should avoid the treatment with bisphosphonates. If it's necessary, maybe teriparatide is the option, but all the recommendations are telling us just that we should not treat the patients with any anti-resorptive or other drug. We can have also idiopathic osteoporosis in this group of patients. In this group also we do not have really data how we can treat them. So coming to the end, how we can treat this group of patients, sure, if it's necessary we should use bisphosphonates, but only orally form. We can use maybe teriparatide, and sure, SERMs are contraindicated. There are also other treatment options, maybe estrogen replacement, surely discontinuation of medications, for example, like depot methoxyprogesterone acetate, which is very bad on the bone, gluten-free diet if it's celiac disease, nutritional rehabilitation, and so on. So to do something about the behavior of the patient. Just to stress to the end, if you will add to these ladies estrogens in the form of oral contraception, it's different if you are using higher dose or lower dose. This is also one of our study where we found that the higher dose of ethinyl estradiol is better on the bone, but the gynecologists are more afraid of the other risk in this group of patients. So let me conclude my speech that low BMD in premenopausal women is not associated with the same risk of fracture as postmenopausal women. That the results from densitometry alone cannot be used for diagnosis of premenopausal osteoporosis. That additional tools such as TBS would help to diagnose, exclude secondary osteoporosis. Most cases of premenopausal osteoporosis are caused by underlying secondary disease and associated with poor bone quality, and that general recommendations about diet and physical activity should be delivered to all premenopausal women, but starting the specific antiporotic treatment should be considered on case by case basis. Thank you very much for attention.
Наступна доповідь Радченко Володимир Олександрович. Особливості хірургічного лікування дегенеративних захворювань серця у пацієнтів похилого віку. Автори Корж, Радченко Попов.
Шановна головуюча, шановна президія.